Sahab, distinguished participants and students. The theme of my presentation today, the keynote presentation for this seminar, is on the challenges facing the health sector in general. Because only when we understand the larger context of the health sector, that we will be in a position to in fact understand as to how we geographers can contribute towards mitigating those challenges or understanding those difficulties that we have. So my presentation is basically in four parts. The first part is, which I partly presented in my inaugural speech very briefly, is what is municipality? You know, and the other three components would basically pertain to, you know, how we geographers could perhaps understand the question of health sector challenges. So let me first of all talk about this. So what do we understand by disparity? You know, many a times disparity is misunderstood as another term for diversity. You know, hamara desh jo hai bahut diverse hai. There are different kinds of cultures. There are different kinds of situations which obtain in our country. This difference in culture or in economy or in the way things are organized around us may not constitute or does not constitute disparity. In dono mein fark hai. In Hindi, we call it vishamata. I don't know whether you call the same thing in Bangla. Or fark. So, you know, so fark hona buri baat nahi. You know, if somebody is tall and somebody is short, no big harm. But if a person who is short because a person was not given enough nutrition, you know, and a person who is tall is given all the food that he or she requires, then it creates, this difference creates or is caused because of the difference in terms of treatment. And that is what leads to disparity. So difference is not good enough. Say for example, you have 100 rupees and I have 100 rupees in my pocket. You know, and if both of us go to the market to buy food, and the food is 110 rupees, both of us are not in a position to get that, you know. So both of us are in the same level with respect to the price in the market. But in case you have 100 rupees and I have 110 rupees, and the food in the market is priced as 110, then, you know, this creates a difference which turns into disparities. You're getting my point? Although there is not much of a difference between 110 and 100. You know, if you have 100 rupees and I have 110 rupees, you know, there's no, it's not a big difference. The difference is created as a consequence of the fact that a certain commodity is priced in a certain manner which makes that particular commodity accessible to me and not to you. So that difference converts into disparity. So that's very important for us to understand, because you know, one of the important issues of the theme which has been displayed here is measurements and methodology. So unless until we understand the conceptual basis behind the method, we will not be in a position to do justice towards understanding as to how we really look at disparities. So diversity or difference is another, disparity is quite a different thing. Disparity is to be understood in terms of what it really contributes towards, you know, what are the outcomes of it, you know. So if there is a particular facility which is accessed by all, and a certain facility is only accessed by a part of the people, part of the members of the society, it creates a difference which has a potential to get converted into disparities. You know, because the one who accesses it is better off and the one who doesn't access it is worse off. So that is an important element which we have to keep in mind, and I'm not going into the theoretical aspects of it, you know, because you know, there is a lot which has been said about and written about, and Principal Saab was mentioning, you know, the political aspects of it, which I'll certainly come at a later aspect, because that is where the crux of the matter is, and he was absolutely right. In the context of geography, or human geography, understanding of the health segment of the issues in human geography, I can see three important areas, you know, in which we have made contributions, and we need to perhaps take a brief look at what are these three major areas in which contributions have occurred and what challenges they pose. First of all, is the area which I refer to as medical geography, or the area which we can refer to as disease ecology. You know, we are not people, you know, who can understand diseases. We are not trained in that profession. We are not doctors, and we are not people from the biological sciences. So what we can do? We can look at least this interface between the conditions of disease or pathogens and the environment, right? You know, this is one area that one could perhaps look at. Say, for example, you know, there are areas which are endemic, goiter areas. You know what is goiter? Goiter is a kind of a disease, you know, which is caused because of deficiency of iodine, right? And there are areas which are endemic in terms of filaria. There are areas where people tend to have, because of certain environmental or maybe other factors, which are not always contributed by the environment, which I shall come to at a later stage, you know, creates a kind of a deformity in the bones, you know. Or there are areas where, you know, because of various other factors which are man-made also, which are contributed by the society, you have onset of certain diseases, you know, which takes place at a very, very early stage in life, right? Say, for example, until about 10 years ago, we only knew that diabetes is a kind of disease, you know, which sets in when you are in your 30s or 40s, you know. But now we are told that there are congenital conditions which are contributing toward diabetes. So children are born with diabetes, you know. So they tend to inherit certain kinds of traits from the mother or from parents. So that means, you know, there are over a longer period of time, certain environmental conditions are creating such genetic, what you can call it, mutations, which may lead to transmission of diseases which were otherwise not considered to be communicable diseases, right? You know, you do not become a diabetic because you're sitting with a diabetic person. You know, even if you share food with a diabetic person, it is not contagious, but it's a lifestyle disease. So there are diseases which we call are environmentally communicable or conditioned kind of diseases, as opposed to diseases which are created because of the lifestyle, which we call diseases of the lifestyle kind or degenerative diseases. कहने का मतलब ये है कि जैसे जैसे हमारी उम्र बढ़ती है और वैसे वैसे डिजीज के दूसरे तरह के आयाम नजर आते हैं जो उसको हम डीजेनरेटिव डिजीज कहते हैं, क्योंकि हमारी बॉडी उस तरह से उन सेल्स के रिप्लेसमेंट नहीं कर पाती है ना, इसको लाइफ, और बाद में कुछ ऐसे हमारे लाइफस्टाइल में परिवर्तन आ जाता है, चेंज आ जाता है। बचपन में हमने नहीं सुना था किसी को कमर की बहुत ज्यादा दिक्कत होती थी, जब तक कि हाँ ये जरूर देखा था हमने बचपन में कि जो बहुत दिनों तक खेत में काम करते थे झुक के, वो बाद में शायद सीधा नहीं हो पाते थे, है ना। तो वो एक लाइफस्टाइल डिजीज है। आजकल बैठे बैठे लोगों की कमर टेढ़ी हो जाती है ना, यानी कि इफ यू सिट फॉर अ लॉन्गर पीरियड ऑफ टाइम यू आर बाउंड टू सफर फ्रॉम सर्टेन काइंड्स ऑफ डिजीजेस, यू नो, इमोबिलिटी हैज कॉज्ड अ नंबर ऑफ इश्यूज, नंबर ऑफ प्रॉब्लम्स, यू नो, सो व्हिच आर लाइफस्टाइल डिजीजेस। सो द पॉइंट दैट आई वाज ट्राइंग टू मेक इज दिस डिजीज इकोलॉजी हैज टू कंपोनेंट्स, वन द इकोलॉजिकल कंडीशंस व्हिच आर एनवायरमेंटली गिवन एंड इकोलॉजिकल कंडीशंस व्हिच आर constantly being changed because of the social, economic and political factors. That means the factors are basically independent of the environment. And there is a third dimension where the environment itself is undergoing a change because of the kind of interventions which we are making, right? Say for example, you know, nobody had even realized that, you know, there are certain kinds, when Green Revolution started in Punjab, nobody could foresee that this Green Revolution and the kind of technology that we were going to use in Green Revolution would create conditions for some kind of a development in future which would convert into a kind of a creation of a cancerous zone. So you have the area which produces maximum wheat in this country is also the area today which is prone to cancer, you know. And this has been discovered now that it is because of excessive use of fertilizer and so many other factors, you know, which has gone much deeper in fact creating environmental changes, you know. So there are instruments or there are interventions which have been made by human beings, you know, which is causing long-term environmental change, right? Say for example, you know, one can say that there are areas here which are arsenic environmentally, you know, but there are areas in Rajasthan which were never arsenic. Today, because of over-irrigation and the kind of changes which have occurred there, is turning into arsenic, right? So therefore, environment responds to the kind of interventions that we human beings make, right? So the point that I was really trying to make, the third point which I said is that there is a pure, pristine environmental conditions which in fact causes certain kinds of deficiencies which can be understood in terms of this disease ecological framework. The second is where, you know, we can see that there are sociological, political and economic conditions or human conditions which are instrumental in causing them. And third is the interface between the two, where environment is undergoing a change because of the constant alterations or interventions which are being made by human beings. Now this is what we call disease ecology. And I think if there is anybody who is better placed to understand this, our geographers. You know, precisely because we don't do pure science in the traditional sense of the term. We are sitting on the margins of the social science as well as the biological and physical sciences. And we have, through our training, we have learned the capacity to in fact integrate the two. So therefore, because in geography, you study regional geographies, right? No. And when we study regional geography, we are talking of yet another format of what we call the ecological conditions, you know? Understanding ecological conditions, keeping human beings in the center is what we geographers can do best. We are not geographers if we are doing physical geography without keeping human beings at the center of it. Then that is what I would rather prefer that to be done by a geologist, you know. A physical, a geomorphology is done better by a geologist when he doesn't bother about human beings, you know. But we geographers